No, seriously, what do you remember from last week, though? Because this is where it really does matter.
Story. You talked about
story. What about it?
He talked about the importance of story and culturally what our stories mean and all that kind of stuff.
Okay, yeah, all that kind of stuff. What else? What else do you guys remember from last week?
Stories motivate action.
Our story and our culture shade how we view the world.
Okay. I would say our story, our story absolutely shapes how we actually view the world. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And the culture that we're a part of actually shapes the story that we actually are a part of, or believe. Okay, good. What else?
So everyone has a belief of, I think it was four things, where everything came from, what went wrong, or maybe it was three things, and how it should be fixed.
Okay. Yeah, that's where we're going to spend a ton of time tonight talking about that, for sure. What else do you guys remember from last week?
Stories give meaning.
Okay.
Context.
Yeah. Do you guys remember that part from last week? That meaning only exists in the context of a story?
Yeah.
Does that sound vaguely familiar?
Yeah.
You gave examples of like taking things out of context, like little stories.
The fox and the tree.
Yeah.
Okay.
The fox and the crow.
Yeah, if you guys remove something out of a context, all of a sudden meaning doesn't exist there anymore. And guys, that is such a huge thing because we often think in terms of the meaning of of particular stories, great, but also the meaning of words are governed by the context that they're in. You guys know what I mean by that?
Yeah.
Did you talk about the word rain last week? It was one of my favorite illustrations. The word rain?
Yeah.
Okay, somebody tell me the definition of the word rain. R-A-I-N. Not R-E, I-G-N, but R-A-I-N.
Precipitation.
Al, what were you saying?
Water.
Yeah, water falling from the sky. Would you guys all agree with that, by the way?
Yes.
Anybody go, not sure? No? Everyone agrees?
Yeah.
Consensus. Okay, awesome. It doesn't have to be technical, but hey, we're all on the same page, even those from Texas. Great. Okay, now watch this. So I was reading the newspaper the other day. I actually still read newspapers. I like the smell of news ink. It's weird. But I was reading the newspaper. High-profile athlete gets in trouble. He's at a club, violence breaks out, law enforcement gets brought in, newspapers interviewing him, and he says, oh man, I was at the club and I was just making it rain and then all kinds of violence broke out. What's he mean?
Throwing money in the air.
Okay, you're going this way, you're saying he's throwing money in the air, and a couple of you are laughing. Why are you doing this, and why did you say
it? Making it rain.
That's the money. He's throwing the money in the air while doing it.
For sure. But why are you guys laughing? Because just a second ago, seriously, 30 seconds ago, we all agreed that the word rain means water falling from the sky. And then literally 30 seconds later, I tell you guys a story. You're making hand motions. You're saying money, and a couple of you guys are laughing. Seems to be like there is consensus, not consensus, but a good number of you understood what that meant, that this guy was making it rain. You guys can do hand motions and know that it's talking about money, and yet literally 30 seconds before, we all agreed that the word rain means water falling from the sky.
Well, artificial rain versus natural rain.
But that's not what we said. We all agreed. I said, is there consensus? We all agree it's water falling from the sky. We said, yeah.
And then, it wasn't limited to, but the context of...
What'd you say? The context did what?
Change.
The context provided meaning. Mm-hmm. And we all understood that. As why? Because meaning is found in the context of a story. Not just for words. Yes, for words. But for what I would argue, and I know what Josh was arguing last week as, is that why stories matter is because it's in the context of a story that we find meaning. Not just the meaning of words. That's fun. I mean, there's all kinds of exercises we can do and draw pictures and do all different things. And that's fun to do with like words and stuff. But stories also provide a context for where we find the meaning of life. And you go, whoa, that's kind of crazy. But I absolutely believe that. When we talk about stories, and I know that right now we live in a society where story language is kind of sexy and going, and I, unfortunately, I think people think that it's just faddish almost. But I would say it's more than just a fad, and it's more than just trying to communicate in a way of like, hey, what's your story? Or tell me your story. Mm-hmm. It's so much more than that, because stories are the very means by which we are ascribing meaning to the world around us. Okay, and so that's why it matters. And I know that's where Josh was talking last week. But if that's true, guys, why do stories matter? Because stories are scalable, because all 7.5 billion people in the world can answer and think in terms of a story. Mm-hmm. Stories matter because it's the very way that God has chosen to communicate to us. He's communicated to us through the context of a story. So we're talking tonight about why stories matter. Next week, we'll start talking about why the biblical story matters. That kind of makes sense to you guys?
Mm-hmm.
But going, guys, stories matter because it's the very means by which we are ascribing meaning to everything in life. That's the mechanism that we use. We don't often think about it, so we have to step back sometimes and go, oh, yeah, that actually plays. That actually is true. So that's why we're talking about what we're doing. Does that kind of make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, not that this is going to sound surprising or even that you would probably engage this way, feel free to throw things at me or ask questions or just push back whenever you guys want, because that's absolutely expected, encouraged, and probably going to be the most beneficial. Does that kind of make sense to you guys? I don't know you guys, and I know that's weird, and I'm going to talk probably really fast. But hey, don't be afraid to go, hey, whoa, time out, stop. I'm not sure I can go where you just went. And that's totally okay. Is that fine? Javon, we're good?
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. Yeah. All right. So talk to me here. What are the elements? Okay, just so you guys know, my name's Spencer. Mary Beth said earlier. Work at a school, have some kids. All my kids are girls. My wife's female. So I'm around women a lot. Used to have a female dog, but she died. But now watch this. Before I was working at the college where I am now, I was a high school English teacher. So my background, I was a high school, I was a literature teacher, I was that guy. And so, sorry if this sounds weird, but I get really excited about like elements of a story, just because it like harkens back to a former life, you know, and it's probably a life most of you would want to like leave far, far behind you. That was high school, you know, it's like, and then I taught junior high too. We're definitely not going there. But if you guys can remember high school or earlier, you guys remember learning the different parts of a story?
Mm-hmm.
What are things that every story has? We're not going to ask you to define them. We're just going to ask you to like list them, because asking you to define them would actually, that's putting, yeah, it's like, I didn't pay attention in school, I just remember that, you know.
Beginning, middle, and end.
Okay, beginning, middle, end. That's actually really helpful.
Climax.
Rising action.
Oh, yeah, the all
the
that
day,
stuff.
The
conflict.
Day.
Conflict, that's a word that's helpful. Yeah, the denouement, that rising action, falling action, all those things, yeah. What else? So we have beginning, conflict.
Resolution.
Yeah, we're always going to get resolution in here somewhere. What else? This constitutes kind of the plot of the story, the things that happen in the story. Every story has a beginning, how it starts, some kind of conflict, resolution, ending. In that, you have rising action, falling action, that basically is between here and here. Every story has an ending, even the never-ending story ending at some point. Which never-ending story doesn't really have legs anymore, because that was, you guys remember that?
Oh, yeah.
Is there anybody old enough to remember that? Because
yes.
I was like, watch, 1984, you know?
Yeah.
Exactly, you know. And it's like, think about this one. How did the never-ending story have a sequel? That never made sense to me. I'm baffled. Anyways, questions you never really have answers to. What else? This all makes up the plot. What else is there?
Characters.
Characters, absolutely.
James.
Hero.
That's a character, Clayton.
Yeah, I
know.
That's the protagonist.
Ooh, big word.
And the antagonist.
Villain.
What else? So we have characters, the hero or protagonist. We definitely have the antagonist, the source of conflict. Setting, where the story is taking place. What else?
Time.
Time. Yeah, I'm going to throw that in the setting side of things, but yeah, because setting is time and place.
Like themes?
Themes. Yeah, perfect. Theme. I know I said I wasn't going to do this. Anybody, what's this? What is this theme? Here's remember. What's the story's about?
Mm-hmm.
I know it's kind of weird because it's like one of those really abstract ideas. It's what the author, what the writer is trying to teach. It's what the story is in its essence, what it's about. Mm-hmm. That kind of makes sense. Past the plot of all the things that happen and going, move past the events of the story and the characters of the story and say, what is the message or the moral that the author is trying to teach us in this? Well, that's the thing, what this whole thing is about. Does that kind of make sense to you guys? Mm-hmm. This will at least give us a starting point and going, here's what I love about this, is do you realize that if you just look at this, all 7.5 billion people in the world can actually answer some of these questions? Mm-hmm. Seriously, watch this. Does everyone in the world have an idea of how things began? Mm-hmm. I'm not saying how they actually, do they agree on it or not? I'm just asking, do they have an idea and could they answer, how did this thing start? Mm-hmm. Yeah, everybody in the world has an answer to that question. Every person in North Hollywood, every person in CD Valley, I think everyone in Texas, but definitely everyone in South America, India, whatnot, they could answer that question.
You started this.
You really did.
And I'll finish it.
How might people answer this question? How it began?
If by you mean the world, right?
Just, like not necessarily. Because some people might not actually start with the beginning of the world. Mm-hmm. Where might they start?
The beginning of their life.
Because, yeah, you know what? This whole story started with me when I was born. You know what I mean? And going, mm-hmm. you went to the beginning of the world, and some people would go, no, it really just started with me.
Yeah.
Now, do you guys see the difference, though? Mm-hmm. Each person has an idea of how it started. Well, how else might people answer this question? Again, we're not looking for if people agree. I'm just curious how people would say this whole thing started.
How the community they identify with started, their cultural group.
Okay, yeah, maybe their people group or their family, whatever group they identify with. Okay, what else? And maybe they make blow it up to the whole idea of the world. Mm-hmm. But how might people answer?
Big Bang.
Big Bang. Okay, some kind of naturalism that it just kind of came into being. What else?
God created it.
Okay, maybe God created
an exploding star.
Yeah, maybe some kind of exploding star. Various creation myths. If you end up in animistic tribal context, you go, man, there's some creation myths out there and creation stories. You know, does that make sense? If you look at certain animistic cultures, it's deities that are in conflict. You know, and there's all kinds of different stories. Again, we're not looking for agreement at this point. All I'm saying is everyone has an idea of how this started. And whether it's starting with the group I'm a part of, starting with me as an individual, or some creation myth, whether it's based in naturalism. You guys, does that make sense to you guys? But here's what I want you to understand. Everyone has an answer here, and however they answer this, it matters. It matters. What do I mean by that? If you think that in the beginning, it started with me, like this whole story, everything around here, it all started when I was born. What might some of the consequences or implications of that actually be later in my life, or the way I actually am thinking and processing and interpreting my life?
Narcissism.
But specifically, I'm sorry, I don't mean this in a condescending way. What does that mean, though? You use words that I can actually wrap my mind around.
Being mean to other people or seeing them as less or something.
Yeah, because I'm just so absorbed with me.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, like I said, I've become incredibly selfish. Because, I'm just not aware of other people. Why? Because it all started with me. You guys see how we identify this actually has consequences. Are you guys tracking a little bit? What happens if you think that, you know what, this whole thing started with my family group or my tribal group? That the whole thing started with my people. What might that emphasize?
Better than others?
Yeah, that all of a sudden the cultural group that I'm a part of may be superior. If I think that, the sun and some other star / moon, were fighting, and through that conflict, was born the Earth, how might that actually impact things? I know that's really weird because I just went into something like crazy. I'm just making crap up at this point, but
maybe make you a warrior culture.
maybe a fighter. I see the value of fighting. I don't know because yeah, they're fighting, and I see good coming out of that. But if I actually see the sun as being something that's a seminal part of the creation of things, what might I actually be doing?
Worship.
Yeah, that might cause me to worship the sun. Does that make sense to you guys? Mm-hmm. I'm going, however I understand the beginning, it has consequences. That's all we're trying to establish here. It has consequences. If I think, now watch this, if I think that in the beginning, life just kind of happened and there was no purpose behind it at all, what might some of the consequences be?
Living an aimless life.
Yeah, living an aimless life. There's no purpose. It's just kind of something that came into being. Right? Does that make sense to you guys? Mm-hmm. And there's, okay, it matters. So, but everyone can answer this question, again, regardless of where you are. You guys tracking a little bit? Okay. What about this side? The conflict. Same thing. You realize every one of your friends, and I want you to think of particular people right now. So actually get a couple people in your mind and think about this for a second. How would they answer this question? What is the biggest problem in the world? How would they answer that?
Some would say greed.
Greed? For sure. What would some of your friends say to that question? Because I have friends that would say that very same thing. Greed or money, finance, yeah. Poverty. It would put it in that financial side of things.
Hatred, lack of love.
Lack of love, hatred, intolerance. Mm-hmm.
Either of the two political parties.
Okay, yeah, government.
Or government.
Yeah, government, politics. 6 months ago, it would have been Obama. 6 months later, it's Trump. Conservatives, Republicans. Republicans, conservatives. Oh, yeah, throw the liberals in there, too. Yeah, sure. What else might people say to be the biggest problem in life? We have money, politics, hatred, intolerance. What else? War? Is that what you said?
War.
Yeah, war. Sure, what else?
Men or women.
Men or women, for sure. What else, guys? You already said something earlier, I think, or maybe it was Joy, I don't remember. Somebody over here said something.
My question is, like, so some people, I think, some of my friends don't necessarily think in terms of, like, the world. They think they're a little more selfish.
Absolutely.
And so they're very but I'm being more, like, in their life.
But watch. Because some of my friends, I agree with you. Some of my friends do think at a macro level. They think in terms of global issues, poverty, politics, you know, greed, too much money or too little money. And they're thinking, you know, war, social justice issues, and that's where they think. But then I have a whole other set of friends that the biggest problem in their life, no joke, the biggest problem in their life is that they're still single. They're not married. Or I have other friends, the biggest problem in their life is they don't have any children. Does that make sense to you guys?
Yeah.
And going, the biggest problem in my life is my health. I'm in failing health. It's the biggest problem in my life. Mm. We're not looking for agreement here. I'm just saying, do you realize that every person in the world can answer this question? What is the biggest problem? Are you guys tracking on that one?
Yes.
And again, for some people, it is going to be at a macro level. But for some, it's going to be intensely personal. And that does affect the way they interpret life. Because if all of a sudden, the thing that I think is the biggest problem in life is the fact that people are being exploited and they're being trafficked, whether it's sex trafficking or some other sort of trafficking where they're exploiting laborers. If I think that's the biggest problem in the world, is that going to affect the way that I actually live, process, and interpret life?
Yes.
Absolutely it will. If I think the biggest problem in life is my health, will that actually cause me to interpret life differently, live life differently? All of a sudden, if I have, now watch this, if I have $100, you know, if I have $100 left over in my account, you know, at the end of the week, end of the month, whatever, and I think the biggest problem in the world is some kind of human trafficking. What might I do with that $100?
Donate it.
donate it to some sort of cause that's going to alleviate this, right? Mm-hmm. If I think the biggest problem in my life, though, is my own health, what might I do with that $100?
Invest it in your health.
Somewhere. Yeah, so
buy some vegetables.
Vegetables, supplements, you know.
Medical bills.
Yeah. Does that make sense to you guys? Mm-hmm. Is all of a sudden, whatever I identify this starts to actually matter. Just tracking?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now watch. Whatever you identify here, whatever your friends would identify here, what does that obligate them to?
Action. Or inaction.
If this is the biggest problem, where are they looking for resolution? Where are people looking for resolution?
Solve the problem.
To solve whatever here. So whatever they, wherever they're looking for resolution, guys, it's based on this. Whatever the biggest problem is in their life, that's where they're going to look for hope. That's where they're looking for resolution. If you think the biggest problem in the world is poverty or money or greed, where do you find hope?
In money.
In money or the acquisition of money or the giving away of money. Does that make sense to you guys?
Mm-hmm.
If I think the biggest problem is the Republican Party, where do I find hope?
The
Democratic Party, right?
Yeah.
Or if I think the biggest problem is the Democratic Party, where do I find hope? I find hope in trying to make America great again. And you go, oh, this is, you know, and you go, oh, okay, that makes sense. But you go, okay, what if I think the biggest problem in the world is the trafficking of innocent people? Where do I look for hope? I mean, you guys get it, right?
Mm-hmm.
If I can just alleviate the exploitation of humanity, everything will be better.
Mm-hmm.
If the biggest problem in my life is the fact that I'm not married, where do I look for hope?
A spouse.
Finding a spouse. And guys, please understand this. If the biggest problem in my life is the fact that I'm not married, I'm going to not only look for hope in finding a spouse, I'm going to be hell-bent on finding a spouse because that's where I'm going to be happy. That's where everything will be better. That's where everything will make sense. Does that make sense? Because that's where everything gets made better. And I will go to any lengths to make that happen then, because that's where there's hope. If the biggest problem in my life is the fact that I can't have children, man, I will go to any length to see that I can have kids. If the biggest problem in my life is my physical health, I will do anything to make sure that my health improves. I'll make crazy financial sacrifices to deal with my health. I'll sacrifice relationships to make sure my health improves, if my health truly is the biggest problem. Are you guys tracking?
Yeah.
What happens if, the biggest problem in the world is my spouse? Where do I look for hope? Maybe somebody else. I need a new spouse. Either my spouse needs to change or my spouse needs to change. You guys know what I mean? I'm going like, they need to change personally, or they need to change them out and get a new one. You know, go for mom 2.0. But you guys understand what I mean here. But whatever you identify here, guys, it actually matters. And these are things that are scalable. These are things that are true of all people. Because this is where we start looking for hope. And it becomes an interpretive process. We don't often think in terms like this on the forefront of our mind, but it's true of us. And you also have this answer here. How might it all end? Because at some point, our lives end, right? But how does this whole story end? Some people are going to say it ends with their own death.
Supernova explosion.
Oh, wow. Supernova explosions. Okay. For sure.
The sun expands.
Okay. What else, guys?
It doesn't.
It doesn't end.
Mm.
Yeah. It keeps going. What do you mean? Play that out a little bit.
Well, I was thinking, like, some people think, like, reincarnation, they come back as a different form of something.
Yeah.
Or they think that, like,
in a larger context, like they may end, but like the world will continue to go on forever.
Sure.
Or
yeah. No, it's great. Now let's just think about this for a second. Let's contrast two very simple understandings of how things might end. The idea that someone's going to be reincarnated, so they're going to come back in another life form based on how they actually lived here, higher or lower life form based on how they lived here, or someone is just, at the end of life, it just stops. I die, all done. Cease to exist, story over. How might those two people live differently?
On one hand, you're trying to, maybe even reincarnation or something else, you're trying to earn what you think will be a better existence.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't believe in anything else, then you kind of live for yourself without any consequences because it doesn't matter.
YOLO. YOLO. That's funny, I haven't heard that in a long time. Hold on.
We hear it all the time.
Jared demonstrated his hip to the culture of like 5 years ago.
That's our life.
What's that?
That's our life.
That's all right. Hey, we're catching up. That's so good. So like super insightful there, because guys, think about that. If I'm living with the belief that at the end of my life I just die and it stops, man, I am going to be all about just the pursuit of pleasure. Because why in the world would I not? Right? On the other side, if I think at the end of my life I'm going to be evaluated and then reincarnated based on how I live this life, man, I'm actually cognizant of that, right? That actually is affecting at some point or another my decisions, right?
Mm-hmm.
You guys are tracking?
Yeah.
It matters. Go ahead.
Would you also say that the combination of the pieces of the story matter as they work together? For example, I would know people that think life ends or you only live once and then you go to the dirt and you cease to exist. But in that, they would say, so because of that, I want to leave things in this world that will continue on, like a legacy or something.
Sure.
Which says something probably, I guess, about their idea of the beginning of the story, as if that's important, or as if purpose, like that this world continue on and get better or something.
No, absolutely.
The beginning.
Absolutely. These things are not, like any story, these things are not siloed. They're not standalone. Like, these things all play together, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know? I absolutely agree that these things are all stitched together into one cohesive story. But guys, this matters. Drop down here real quick. If you were to think again of your friends or even yourself, who's the main character in the story that you find yourself a part of? Like, if you were to ask your friends that's a weird question, and most of them go, what the heck are you talking about? But how would the people you interact with, what would they say to that question? Who's the main character?
Me.
They would say you?
Themselves.
I was like, wow, bold. Wow, the main character in my story.
But they
would
usually say themselves, because...
Yeah.
Or their kids.
Or their children, yeah.
No, for sure. They would say themselves, or they might say that their children,
mm-hmm.
absolutely. Or they might say their family, or their tribal group, or whatever team they're a part of. Because, yeah, for some people who are in more of a corporate identifying culture, they're going to go, wow, maybe the whole story isn't about me, but it is about the group that I'm a part of. Whether that's my family, or the tribal group, or the larger people group, but for sure. But some people will say themselves. What else? You guys get the idea, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Guys, the main character of the story, that's a crazy thing to process. Who's the story actually about? And then what about down here? What's the purpose of this story? And I go, whoa, that's crazy. You're talking like purpose of life stuff now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I am. What's the purpose? What's the theme? What is the story that you are a part of? What is it all about? What would people say? Most of them would go, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But if you were to watch their life, what would they actually say? Or you might have to press them a little bit. But what would they say life's about?
Be happy.
Be happy? Yeah, pleasure. Pursuit of pleasure. What else?
Success.
Success. Yeah, legacy. Success. Prestige. What's that?
Learning.
Learning. A life of learning. Okay, what else?
Family.
Family. Pleasure, learning, family.
I think a lot of people would say giving or helping
okay.
other characters.
Okay. Helping others. Okay.
They may not, nobody lives into that real well, but.
No. We're not looking for consistency at this point. We're just saying how people might actually answer it. Okay. And I would even argue some people would say security or comfort. They probably wouldn't maybe say security, they'd probably say comfort. But those things are really the same, you know. Guys, we need to understand something, though, that every act in life, everything that we do, is always interpreted. I don't know if you guys ever think about that, that everything we do is an interpreted act. What do I mean by that? It's always interpreted in light of the story you're a part of. Watch this. Check under your seat real quick if there's an envelope with any money in it. No, if there's like $100 under your seat. No? Okay, but let's say that there's not, by the way. I just curious.
I'm really excited about that
illustration. Well, I'm too poor for you to throw that out.
I thought you wanted to say
that. That would be my wildest dream.
But now,
this isn't Cornerstone Simi, okay?
No, Cornerstone Simi, I have to be a dollar amount. Now watch this, though.
$1,000. Oh, okay, now I'll look.
But guys, watch this for a second. Let's say you found $1,000. So, let's say, it's in a bag with your name on it. Someone just leaves it for you. It's not like you randomly find it, it might be somebody else's. This is designated for you, but you have no clue where it came from. But it's for you. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
What do you do with that $1,000? That's not a rhetorical question. I'm actually curious.
Pay off debt.
Pay loan.
Pay off debt. Pay off debt.
Save it.
Save. Jovan, what do you do?
I'm just thinking it'd be whatever is at the top of the priority list. So.
Okay, well, right?
Yeah.
Okay. What would you do? $1,000.
Shop.
Okay.
Shop.
Vacation?
I said savings.
Savings?
Put it into an EP.
Okay.
Music.
Invest into some music.
Yeah.
Maybe give some away. Maybe.
Maybe give some away.
Double maybe.
Okay.
Double maybe.
Guys, what's fascinating is how you actually view that $1,000. Please understand this. How you view that $1,000 is absolutely 100% governed by the story that you are actually living in light of. Because that use of $1,000 is actually an interpreted act. And it's interpreted based on all of this. It's interpreted based on who the main character is and really what's the purpose of life. Because if you think being faithful to your bills is important, you know, and faithfulness matters, I want to make sure I pay off debt. If I think, you know what, a pursuit of, you know, music is really important, then all of a sudden that's a good use of that money. Right? If I think generosity matters, all of a sudden giving it away makes sense. Right? If I think seeing a different part of the world or vacationing or pleasure, it matters, then I would vacation. Does that make sense to you guys?
Mm-hmm.
Going, what starts to get exposed is, simply how I view money is an interpreted act. It's not neutral.
Mm-hmm.
Money just isn't money. Money is something that it's something that we interpret.
Mm-hmm.
But so is everything else.
Yeah.
The people we work with, they're not actually just people. They're actually, those are things that we interpret. I know that's weird to call a person a thing that we interpret, but it is. Because are you going to ascribe value to that or not? Well, why would I ascribe value to another person? Well, because of the story that I'm a part of.
Mm-hmm.
You know, all of a sudden, everything we're doing in life, guys, is always interpreted in light of the story that we find ourselves a part of. It matters immensely. Does that even come close to making sense?
Can you say, interpret it, like just use a new word to use that so I can, because it define it a little bit differently so I can wrap my mind around it a bit.
We are always evaluating things based on the story that we are a part of. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah, and so we're making evaluative judgments. We're judging things and evaluating them based on the story we're a part of. And so whether it's, you know, having children, are these my kids? Are they my responsibility? Are they society's responsibilities? Are they somebody else's responsibility? Well, are they the school's responsibility? Well, that's an interpretive or an evaluative act that I'm actually entering into and going, wow, I have some degree of responsibility because the way I'm actually interpreting these three people are somehow they are my responsibility to actually care for. Somebody else might say, no, it's the group's responsibility to care for them. Somebody else, well, somebody, you know, it's no one's responsibility. Let them do whatever they want. You know, so, does that kind of make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it's a great question. Now, does this make any, even a little bit of sense?
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking nonsense in some ways, because it's like, really, why are we going down this road? Here's why. And realize very quickly that God has chosen to communicate to us also in the context of a story. Okay? Example. In the biblical story, what's our understanding of the beginning?
God created the heavens and the earth.
Okay?
Well, even he existed before that.
It's like he's telling us what our beginning.
Sure. No, for sure. Yeah, but we get this idea of creation,
mm-hmm.
right? In the beginning, God created. That's how this whole thing started, right?
Mm-hmm.
What's the biggest problem in the story?
Sin entered the world.
Yeah, sin. Sin or rebellion. How does it get better then?
Jesus
Christ.
Yeah, Jesus. Because Jesus is the hope for redemption. I mean, that whole idea of redemption, he's redeeming creation. Okay, sin made it bad. Jesus is going to fix it. Then how does it end?
Salvation.
Eternal
reconciliation. Somebody's saying something over here. Is there a new heaven? Yeah, this idea of someone said salvation, but I would say that that's part of it, but it's not the totality of it. It's this idea of new creation. New heavens, new earth, and that those who are actually redeemed get to be a part of that.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense to you guys?
Mm-hmm.
And you go, oh, wow, all of a sudden God's communicating to us in that same framework. Real quick, in the biblical story, who's the main character?
Jesus. The Trinity.
You know, that's actually a brilliant answer. Most people say, yeah, the Godhead, the Trinity, you know, all the, you know, because it's not just Jesus, it's God,
mm-hmm.
you know, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. I would say mostly emphasizing Jesus, but really that's God. God is the main character of the story. What's the purpose then of this whole story?
His glory.
Okay.
To worship.
Okay, yes. That word, it's entirely accurate, but not very helpful. You guys know what I mean by that?
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead. I said, what's the purpose? What's the theme of this whole story? And he said, God's glory. I said, that's entirely accurate, but not very helpful.
Love.
It's to explain God.
Okay, to explain God. Guys, I want to stay on this word glory for a second because it is accurate. But does anybody in your normal everyday life ever use the word glory?
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Jay-Z song.
Say it again? Okay.
For playing non-spiritual.
No, I'm not sure. I just.
That's it.
Okay, I just don't interact with people that's a normal word,
that's
and so I generally find people that generally use that word, but they have no clue what it means.
Mm-hmm.
So use that same idea of glory, but make it accessible. Use language that actually makes sense to me, and I'm not very smart.
Praise.
Okay, praise.
Everything points to the edification of that.
Okay, everything points to that. So it's the edification is still a weird word, though. We want to use words that are actually accessible.
Attention.
Attention? Yeah, no, that's actually good. You're actually drawing attention to it. Does that make sense to you guys? You go, well, okay. Yeah, you're showing it off. You're putting it, you're making it seen.
Mm-hmm.
You guys are tracking with me?
Yeah.
Oh, good. Because ultimately, I think that is what glorify God means. It's like, hey, putting God on display, making God known, drawing attention to him. Does that make sense? But it's like, because let's be honest, I don't know how to glorify God with my kids. That's like, oh, I don't, ah. But all of a sudden you go, how do you put God on display with your kids? Oh, I can, that makes sense to me. You know what I mean? I'm going, I get, that, but that's me, because I'm, I know. They're going, guys, I said, the purpose then in the biblical story is to draw attention to God, to put God on display, to make God known, to glorify God. Absolutely. Does that make sense to you guys?
How does love and God is love fit thematically?
For sure. Yeah, the idea of God.
Hoppa!
That's right. Blame it on the baby. Blame it on the baby.
Hey, you gonna get your Bible?
Okay. Great question. How does God is love fit on this one? I'm actually gonna push that off till next week. It's a great question. It's a totally fair question. But I would say, if you understand what God's intention was in the beginning, I'll give you an answer, and then we're gonna have to flesh it out next week. If you understand in the beginning what God's purpose for humanity was, and it's to put himself on display, this idea of, you guys ever heard the term image bearing? Like,
yes.
That we're created in God's image?
Yes.
What does that mean? Even that's a weird word. That we're to reflect God. Because what does it mean to reflect or to be an image bearer? Well, like a mirror is an image bearer because it reflects an image, right? Going, this idea of an image bearer is one who displays God, right? And so if that's what God's purpose was for humanity, to put himself on display, to have people that will reflect him to the world, that's what it means to be created in God's image. We are an image bearer. Then when we actually are engaging in love, then we're actually putting God on display. Does that make sense? I don't know if...
Yes.
I mean, I hijacked where we're going next week and tried to not leave you hanging too much. We'll flesh that out next week. But here's where I want to be tonight, guys. Please, please, please understand this part. Everyone thinks in these frameworks. Everyone does. Including you and I. But God also chooses and has communicated to us in a very similar framework. Creation, fall, redemption, new creation. The main character of the story, a lot of people in the world are going to be tempted to go, yeah, the main character in the story is me. The main character in the story is my kids or my family. But God's entering into that and saying, no, I'm the main character. This story is about me. And then ultimately, what's the purpose of the story? For some people, it's going to be, wow, just pleasure. Or some people, it's going to be security or comfort. But God's entering into that story and going, no, guys, the whole story is about putting me on display or making me known. All of a sudden, that $1,000 that I have, if the main purpose of the story is going, wow, how can I put God on display with this $1,000? And what does that even mean? Wow, maybe the best thing I can do with this $1,000 is to be faithful to the debt that I owe. And because that would actually put God on display well. Maybe. Maybe the best thing I can do with that $1,000 is give it to other people, because that would put God on display well. Maybe the best thing I can do with that $1,000 is buy a really nice barbecue and invite all my friends over. Maybe. Maybe the best thing I can do with that $1,000 is, you guys understand, but I'm thinking differently about that $1,000. It's still an interpreted act, but I'm interpreting it through, wow, what's going to put God on display here? What will glorify God here? What will make God known? All of a sudden, what I'm thinking in terms of parenting, I'm thinking, wow, how can I put God on display here? Because every act is an interpreted act. All people are actually things that we interpret or make evaluative judgments on. So now my coworkers, I'm thinking, wow, they just mistreated me. They just spoke horribly to me. You know what? That's not the biggest problem in the world. The biggest problem in the world isn't that my coworkers are actually being a pain in the ass. The biggest problem in the world is, sorry about that, the biggest problem in the world is sin. And wow, my coworker is a sinner, just like me. Where is their hope then? Oh, wow, there's hope in Jesus in that. how can I put Jesus on display right now with my coworker who's being a pain in the butt? Because that actually puts Jesus on display. Does that make sense? But everything in life is an interpreted act. And so here's the question that we all have to ask. What is the primary story that is shaping the way you interpret the world? Are you living in light of a cultural story, or are you living in light of the biblical story? What's shaping you? Because you cannot have two stories that you're living in light of. You have one story that is affecting the way that you are making sense of the world. And the question is that the cultural story? Is that the story of North Hollywood? Is it the story of Austin? Is it the story of, you know, America? Is it the story of, like, progressive youth? Or is it the biblical story? Because I would say we all go sideways when we allow our cultural story to be primary and we allow the biblical story to become secondary. As followers of Jesus, guys, we have to strive to make sure that this biblical story is our primary identity and our primary calling. Because this is what it's about here. We all live in a cultural story. Wow, we may live within the context of North Hollywood. We may live within the context of a progressive youth. We may live in the context of, you know, Texas arrogance, but that's not who we are. That's not who we are. That's simply the context of where we are, but it's not who we are. And guys, we're living at that tension, that crossroads of the cultural story and the biblical story, and the reality of why we need to gather together regularly is so that we can call each other back to this and go, man, you know what? Jovan, I've noticed that in the way you're conducting your business, man, you're starting to live in light of the cultural story a little bit here. And thus, you're actually not doing a good job of putting Jesus on display. Wow, Allie, I've noticed in the way that you're parenting, you're starting to parent just like the world does, and you're not actually striving to put Jesus on display here. Or all of a sudden, I need to ask, wow, hey guys, I don't know how to be a good husband. Man, can you guys help me think through this? How can I love my wife in a way that's actually going to make God known to my neighbors? All of a sudden, the reason we gather together is so that we could actually be reminded of the biblical story and how to do this well and encourage each other in that. Because all of us, and if you guys are honest with each other and yourselves, all of us have areas of our life where we are absolutely being shaped by the cultural story. Absolutely. And it's going, okay, acknowledge that and go, wow, what does repentance look like? What does it look like to actually go, Jesus, I need help here? Because we're all there. Somewhere in the story, we've gone sideways. And going, guys, just absolutely recognize all of us are living in light of a story. The idea of a story is scalable. God's called us to live out the reality of a story, but he's called us to the biblical story. And the biblical story is absolutely clear. It's about God and putting him on display and thinking biblically about all things. And the tension then, guys, is, yeah, what story are you living in light of? Biblical story or the cultural story? And that tension is why we need to gather together. So that's kind of where we are for tonight. Next week, we're going to start talking about some specifics about the biblical story. Because we're going to drop down into one. So last week, Josh was talking big picture. This week, we tried to give it a little bit of structure. Next week, we're going to talk about more of this here, the biblical story, and what does that actually look like. And then in a couple weeks, we'll start talking practically. Okay, then how does that biblical story practically play itself out? That kind of makes sense to you guys?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
You guys have any questions, comments, concerns about things? Or want to tell me how I'm absolutely wrong? Because I'm totally okay with that. I'll just blame Jared. So, guys, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Spencer.
So good.
Yep.
Thank you.
5 minutes left.
You're good, man.
Perfect.
That's great.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thanks.
Can I pray for us real quick? And then I don't know if you guys, I just like to pray, and I'm in a season of life where I think prayer really matters. I forget that sometimes. Jesus, thanks for these folks. Thanks for their willingness to give up time on a Wednesday night. I know that life is busy. Life gets a little bit chaotic and crazy. Again, thanks. Thanks for the fact that they're willing to come together and just challenge each other to think biblically. God, what a huge encouragement just to see people who are committed to that. I pray that you would allow them to absolutely be shaped by your story, that they would see the need to think biblically about everything. God, because our world, the world we live in, North Hollywood, this community, is absolutely trying to shape how we interpret life. And God, may we fight against that so that we're not conforming to the story of the world, but we are indeed being transformed by your story. God, may that be true for each one of us. May we absolutely be overwhelmed by how much you love us. God, but you've got to teach us that. May you teach each one of us how much you absolutely love us. That you can't love us any more or any less than you absolutely already do. God, thanks. In your name, amen.